दिस वी डिस्कस्ड यस्टरडे. ओके, सो टाइप्स ऑफ अरेज, टू टाइप्स ऑफ अरेज वी हैव, वन डायमेंशनल अरे एंड टू डायमेंशनल और मल्टी डायमेंशनल अरेज. ओके, सो वन डायमेंशनल अरे, हाउ वी डिफाइन वन डायमेंशनल अरे, इट इज ए लिस्ट ऑफ एलिमेंट्स और ए कलेक्शन ऑफ एलिमेंट्स दैट कैन बी गिवेन वन वेरिएबल नेम यूजिंग वन सबस्क्रिप्ट. ओके, सो इफ यू यूज ओनली वन सबस्क्रिप्ट देन दैट वेरिएबल इज कॉल्ड ए वन डायमेंशनल अरे. ओके, सो how we declare one dimensional array, if you see the general form, this is what we discussed: data type followed by array name and the size of the array. Okay, so examples we have seen here: int x of 10, that means here x is an array of 10 integer elements, float salary of 50, so here salary is an array of 50 floating point type elements. Okay, so this is how we declare array and initialization. Also yesterday we discussed it, and we have written a sample program demonstrating a one dimensional array. Okay, so how to use one dimensional array in the program we have discussed here. Okay, then once we store elements into the array, then using the same for loop you can access elements of the array using this for loop. Okay, so that is what we discussed today. We'll try to see some programs where this one dimensional array is used. Okay, so what we do is we'll write some programs on one dimensional array. Okay, so this we discussed today, that is on 28/10/2020, so that you will get hands-on practice of using a one-dimensional array in programs. Okay, so what type of programs we'll write? Okay, so first we'll write a program to find the maximum and minimum number, maximum and minimum okay, so minimum from a list of numbers. List of numbers. This is how the question will be asked. Okay, so this is one program we'll do. Then the second program is program to find the sum of elements in an array. These two programs, okay, will perform today. Okay, so finding maximum number and minimum number, and I told its application where this kind of problem will encounter in a real time. That means if you store ages of students in a class, then if you want to find out who is the elder student and who is the younger student, then if you find maximum age and minimum age of students, then you'll get answer for those two questions. Similarly, if you store salaries of all the employees in an organization. Okay, so if you want to find out how much total I am paying every month in the form of salaries. Okay, so then if you find a sum of elements of an array, then that gives the result. Okay, so we'll do these two programs. Straight away we'll go to code blocks, and there we'll write these two programs. Okay, so I'll copy this. So the first program finding maximum and a minimum from a list of numbers. Okay, so include the header file. Now if you can practice with me, then it would be better. Then begin the main. Okay, so write the main and begin the main here. Okay, So the first thing that should come into your mind is what are the variables we required. Based on your problem, given problem, you need to identify what are the variables. So you have a list of numbers. That means you required a one-dimensional array. So first you declare a one-dimensional array, okay, so called as a num of some size 30, 40 or some 50 you declare. Okay, then similarly, you are not going to store all the 50 elements. Okay, so you may be storing some 10 elements, 15 elements, like that. Okay, so then to store that, how many elements user wants to store in the array. Okay, so declare a variable called as a n, and we require a loop control variable. For that, you declare a variable called I, which is used as a loop control variable. And similarly, we need to find a maximum and a minimum number. Okay, so those two you store in two variables. One is called max and another one is called min. Okay, so these are the two variables we require. Okay, so these are basic variables that we required for this program. Okay, so first ask the user to enter how many elements he wants to store in the array, because we have declared space for 50 elements, but user not interested to store all the 50 elements. So that's why ask the user here. Okay, so with arrays, this should be asked. How many elements? Enter how many elements or how many numbers you can. Okay, so here we said list of numbers, no? So that's why you ask the users how many numbers are there. Okay, so he enters 5, 10 something. Okay, so then read the numbers. Say scanf percentage d, then where to store the value? In the address of n. Okay, so then end with the semicolon. So you save the program so that you can see different colors for your keywords. Okay, so I'm saving the program here. So what is this program? Maximum and minimum. Okay, so now you say max min dot c. Okay, so dot c automatically it takes. Now you can see different colors appearing on the screen. Okay, so then this looks good, and easily you can identify the errors. Okay, now user entered a number, so many numbers he wants to, some n numbers he wants to store. Okay, so then those n numbers you have to read from the keyboard and store in the array. Okay, so that's why give a message to the user, say printf enter percentage d numbers, enter percentage d numbers comma, then here you give n value. Okay, so it takes the n value from here and prints here, so that you can see enter 5 numbers. Okay, so user enters all the 5 numbers, like 5, 8, 20, okay, 15, 46, like that. Some randomly he enters some 5 numbers. So and your program has to read and store those 5 numbers in this array called as a num. Okay, so you cannot read all the numbers at a time. One by one you have to read. Okay, so that's why you require a for loop here. So for I is equals to 0, I less than n, how many elements? N elements are there. So I belongs, or I equals to, until I becomes equals to n. That is how we'll write the condition in programming, I less than n. Okay, so I plus plus. Now read the number. How to read? Scanf, then percentage d comma, where to store? Address of, in this array. Okay, so what is the array name? Num here, num of, and where, which place? I, I is the index of the array. Okay, so then the array reads all the 5 numbers and stores in this for loop, reads all the 5 numbers and stores into this array. Okay, so num of 0, num of 1, num of 2, that way the elements will be read into the array. Now you have numbers. You have numbers in the array. Okay, so just let me open yesterday's. Yeah, this one. Okay, right. So this is your array. Assume five elements. Okay, so randomly you might have entered some numbers. Okay, so here what I do is I take this as a 5. Okay, this as 20. Okay, so this I take as a 12. Okay, so then this I take as a 8. Okay, so this I take as a 15. Assume user entered randomly five numbers and those five numbers are stored in this array. Okay, now you have to find the maximum number and also the minimum number from this array. Okay, so go back to our program now. So what I do is here, first I consider this first number as the maximum number and also minimum number. Okay, so that I search in the array and find out whether there is any other program which is greater than this. Then if yes, then that will become the maximum number. And I also search a second time whether there is any number which is less than this. Okay, if yes, then that will become the minimum number. Otherwise, this will become the minimum number. That is the logic we'll implement here. Okay, right. So what I am doing here, I am assuming the first number itself. So min is equal to max is equals to num of 0. Okay, so where is the first number? In num of 0. So first number itself I am considering as the maximum and a minimum. Then afterwards, from second element onwards, I go on a search. Okay, so now use a loop, because repeatedly you have to search until you reach end of the array. Okay, so that's why I use a for loop here. So for I is equals to 1, this time I use I is equals to 1, because this already I assumed as the maximum number. Now from this onwards, I'll go on searching whether there is any other number which is greater than this. Okay, so that's why I start the loop beginning from 1 here. Okay, so for I is equals to 1, then I less than n, then say I plus plus. Okay, so inside the loop, now you know this first number where you stored in a variable called min and max. You know the second number which is in num of 1. Now these two numbers, now you compare. Okay, so now I am comparing. If first what I do is I search for minimum number. Okay, so if num of I, that means num of 1, if num of 1 is less than minimum, if num of 1 is less than minimum, okay, that means if this is less than this, then this will become the minimum. For example, if this is 2, okay, so num of 1 means 2. 2 less than 5, yes, yes means now this should become the minimum number. Okay, right. So if this condition is true, that indicates that minimum is equal to num of I. Num of I is the minimum. Otherwise, num of 0 is the minimum. Okay, so this way, now this loop repeatedly searches in the array and checks every time whether there is any number which is less than minimum number. If yes, then that will become the minimum number. Otherwise, min will be the minimum number. Okay, so just a minimum number I'll explain here. Afterwards we'll write the same code for a maximum number also. Okay, now see here what happens. First I is equals to 1. Okay, so 1 less than 5, yes. Okay, so enter the loop. Then num of 1 less than minimum, what is num of 1? Assume 2 is it. Okay, so 2 less than 5, yes. 2 less than 5, yes. Okay, so then minimum is equal to num of 1. Okay, so previously in minimum I stored 5. Okay, now minimum is equal to num of 1. What is there in num of 1? 2. 2 will be stored in a minimum. Okay, now minimum contains the value 2. Okay, right? So end of the loop reaches, then goes up I plus plus. I becomes now 2. 2 less than 5, yes. Then num of 2 is less than minimum. Now see here, num of 2 means 12. 12 less than 2, no, false. So then if this is false, then this statement is not executed. Clear? Okay, so then end of the loop reaches, then control goes to increment section, I plus plus, I becomes 3, 3 less than 5, yes, true. Okay, so then num of 3 less than minimum, what is num of 3? 8, 8 less than 2, no, false. So since it is false, again goes up and increments the I value, I plus plus. I becomes now 4. 4 less than 5, yes. Then num of 4 less than minimum. Num of 4 is what? 15. 15 less than 2, no, false. Okay, so this is false. False means it won't execute this statement. Then end of the loop reaches, goes to increment section, I plus plus, I becomes 5, 5 less than 5, false. Then comes out from the for loop. Okay, so there you can see the minimum number stored in the variable called as a min. Okay, so same logic you can apply to find the maximum number also. Control C. Okay, so instead of writing another loop, in the same loop, first you check for minimum, then immediately you check for maximum. Okay, so then here you can check for a max here. Num of 1, this time it is greater than max. If num of 1 is greater than max, then max is equal to num of 1. Then max is equals to num of 1. Now this is the for loop. Okay, so in the same way how it sets the minimum number, then it performs the same kind of task for searching the maximum number. Okay, so initially it starts with the num of 1, 2, 2 less than 5, sorry, 2, num of 1 is 2, 2 greater than 5, no, false, nothing is executed. Then 12 greater than 5, yes, then 12 will become the maximum. Then 8 less than 12, now this is the maximum number now. Okay, so 8 less than 12, no, false. Then again it goes to next number, 15 greater than 12. Here it searches, 15 greater than 12, yes. Okay, so then max is equal to num of I, 15 will be stored in a max. Okay, now minimum we are storing in min and maximum we are storing in a man. That means we are searching the entire array for both minimum and maximum numbers. Okay, so once you come out from the loop, you print, you have both minimum and maximum numbers. Now you print here, printf, the minimum number is equals to percentage d . Okay, minimum number is equal to percentage t, and where we store that in a variable called as a min, give the variable name here. Okay, similarly maximum number you can print here. Just say print. How to print the maximum number? You can say the maximum number is equal to maximum number is equals to percentage d, then slash n, close here. Comma max. Okay, then end with the semicolon. So save the program, then finally return 0. What is the problem here? This is in black color, this is in blue color. Printf. So here we miss a double quotes, that's why both should be in the same color actually. So it is in insert. Okay, the maximum number is equals to, okay. So now, if you print both minimum and maximum by printing these two variables, min and max, you will get minimum number and a maximum number. Okay, so this is the program using one dimensional array to find a minimum number and a maximum number. So what we are doing first, we are declaring an array, then we are asking the user to enter how many numbers he wants to store in the array. Okay, so that we are catching in n. Then we are asking the user to enter those many elements. So all the elements we are reading into the array by using this for loop. Okay, so once you have numbers in the array, then initially the first element you are considering as the minimum number and the maximum number. Then from second element onwards, you are searching here for minimum number and also you are searching for a maximum number. Okay, so if the condition becomes true here and here, then that will become the minimum number here, maximum number here. So like this, you go on search the array until it reaches end of the array. Okay, so once there are no more elements in the array and the control comes out from the loop, and if you print minimum and maximum variables, then that gives the minimum number and the maximum number. Okay, so we'll see the execution, how your program identifies minimum and maximum numbers. Okay, so first to build the program. So zero errors here, zero errors, zero warnings. Okay, so now run the program. Now it is asking, see there, enter how many numbers. For example, I enter 5. Enter 5 numbers, it is asking. Okay, so randomly you enter some 5 numbers. And say 43. Now 22, 12, 5, 16, 43. These 5 numbers I entered. Okay, now we can see minimum number is equal to 5, maximum number is equal to 43. So here it is the minimum number and this here is the maximum number. That is what your program identified. Okay, so like this you can test your program with different input numbers. 10 numbers, 20 numbers you can enter and you can identify the minimum and the maximum numbers from the list. Okay, clear? So this program I'll copy here so that this is our program. Okay, so this is the first program. Any doubts in this program? Do you have any doubts in this? No? Yeah. So we'll go to next program. So what is the second program? Program to find a sum of elements in an array. Sum of elements. Or sum of numbers you can. Okay, so this program will perform now. So okay, right, so then include the header file. Okay, first I'll save the program. Then what is this number? Sum of array, kada? Okay, so otherwise array sum I'll array sum dot c. So what is the next one? Including the header file, write the main function. Okay, so main function, then after begin the main. Okay, so what are the variables required here? The first line in the memory is variable declaration. Inside the main is variable declaration. So you need to identify what are the variables required for solving this problem. Okay, so sum of elements in an array. Okay, so that means you require one dimensional array. So you call it as sum A of a size 50. Okay, so then you need to ask the user how many elements he wants to store in the array that you catch in the variable called as n, and we require a loop control variable I. Okay, so sum, you have to add the number sum you required. So initially declare a variable sum and initialize it to 0. Okay, so these are the different variables we required here. Okay, so first same thing, ask the user to enter how many elements. How many elements the user wants to store in the array. So read that. Using the scanf function and store in the variable called as a n. Okay, so now user wants to store n numbers. Okay, so then those numbers must be entered through keyboard. So that means you give a message to the user to enter. How to write here? Enter percentage d numbers. Okay, so percentage d numbers, then after the comma give where from it should be printed. So n, so enter 5 numbers. If you enter n value as 5 numbers it prints. Now how to read those 5 numbers? To read elements into the array we require a for loop, that you should remember. Okay, so for I is equals to 0, then what is the next condition to be used? I less than n, then I plus plus. Okay, so how we can read? Using the scanf function through keyboard is entering. So percentage d comma address of, what is the array name? A of I. A of I. Okay, so now you have elements in the array. Now you have some elements in the array. So you find a sum of elements of this array. Okay, so this is the code for finding the sum of element. So this loop, find the sum. This loop is to find the sum of elements in the array. Okay, now so already numbers are there. Now you have to write the logic. That means from first number onwards, go on first number, second number, third number, like this until you reach end of the numbers. Okay, so you add all the numbers and store the result in a variable called as a sum. And finally, if you print sum, that gives sum of elements in the array. Okay, so what I am doing is I start from the first element onwards, I is equal to 0, then I less than n, then I plus plus. So I'm repeatedly adding the numbers. So how can we add the numbers? Where are the numbers? In A of 0, A of 1, A of 2. Okay, so that you have to add to sum. Okay, so that means sum plus A of 0, A of 1. 0, 1 where we are storing in A of I. Sum is equal to sum plus A of I. But if you say sum is equal to sum plus A of I, the result must be caught into a variable. So where we'll store? Again, we'll store the result back in a sum. Sum is equals to, now we say, sum is equal to sum plus a of I. Okay, so this way you can add all the elements in the array. So here we have same type of variable on the left hand side and right hand side. Which one we can use here? In short form, you can write this in shorthand notation. Okay, so that means if same variable is repeating here, it is not required here. Okay, so you can just say sum plus is equal to a of I. That means add a of I to sum. That is what we are informing the compiler. Okay, so I is equal to 0, a of 0 will be added to sum. I is equal to 1, a of 1 will be added. I is equal to 2, a of 2 will be added. I is equal to 3, a of 3 will be added to sum. So like this, it goes on finding the sum of first element, second element, third element, fourth element until there are no numbers. Okay, so where are we storing the result sum? In the variable called as sum. So if you print that, then you will get, say, printf sum of array elements is equal to sum of array elements is equal to percentage d, and where from we have to print? From the variable sum. Give the variable name sum. Okay, so then finally you say return a 0. That's it. Okay, so this is your program to find sum of elements in the array. So what we did here, we declared an array. Okay, so then we ask the user to enter how many elements he wants to store, and we got that value into the variable n. Okay, then we are asking the user to enter those number of elements. Okay, and we are reading those elements into the array by using this for loop and the scanf function. Okay, so once you are done, then you have array with you with different numbers. Now you find the sum. So first element, second element, third element, like this, you go on add the elements from the array and add to the sum. That's okay. So if you print the variable sum, that gives sum of all the elements in the array. Clear? So we'll execute this. Let me save the program. First build the program. So check whether it is built successfully or not. So there is some error. See here. Okay, so error here, it is saying error. Okay, so I have not a hash symbol there, so that's why it is giving error. Hash include it should be. So save again build the program. So this time zero errors, zero warnings. That means there are no errors. So now you run the program. Now it is asking enter how many elements. 5 elements. Okay, so enter 5 numbers, it is saying. So randomly you enter some 5 numbers. Now you can see sum of array elements is equal to 18. So 2 plus 1, 3 plus 5, 8 plus 4, 12 plus 6, 18. Right? 18 it has printed. Clear? Okay, so this way we can write programs by using one dimensional array, and you can perform various tasks on that one dimensional array. Any doubts in this? So just I'll copy this into the notes. Right, now this is story of a one dimensional array. Next we'll discuss about a two dimensional array. Two dimensional array, okay, so how we can define a two dimensional array? A list of numbers can be given, okay, so a list of numbers or a list of elements, you can say, because it may not be numbers always, sometimes it may be some characters also. Okay, so a list of elements, you can say, can be given one variable name. One variable name using two subscripts, okay, or you can also call them as a dimensions, two dimensions, and such a variable is called a two dimensional array. So if you use only one dimension, one set of subscripts, then that is called a one dimensional array. And if you write two subscripts, then that is called a two dimensional array. Okay, so where we use this two dimensional array can be used to store, okay, to store what type of a table of values, okay, a table of values, if you have some value stored in the form of a table, okay, or you want to store matrices. Previously one dimensional array for storing vectors, okay, but here if the data is in the form of some matrix, we can use a two dimensional array. Okay, so how to declare two dimensional array? Declaration of two dimensional array. Okay, so general form you take here. If you consider the general form, how do you declare? Data type. Okay, so then followed by array name. Then now we have two set of square brackets here. Each set is called dimension here. Okay, so two sets we use, two dimensions we, that's why it is called a two dimensional array. Okay, so what does the first dimension indicate? Okay, so the first dimension indicates the number of rows, and the second dimension indicates the number of columns. Number of columns here. Okay, so then end this definition with a semicolon. So this is the general form of declaring a two-dimensional array. Data type, then array name. In the first subscript, give the how many number of rows, and in the second subscript, in each row, how many columns are there. Okay. So here, already you know data type, what it indicates. Okay. So I'll just say this. Rows indicates here. The number of rows in the array. How many number of rows in the array? That will be indicated by this row, because you are going to store a matrix. So matrix contains rows and columns. Similarly, here in general form, what I do is I write this as just calls. Okay, so calls indicate number of indicates the number of columns in the array. Okay, so rows indicates number of rows and columns indicates number of columns in the array. So example, if you consider, so int, okay, so some matrix you want to store, say M, I'll say M of, okay, so 3x5 matrix if you want to store, or 3x4 matrix if you want to store, then you can declare a two-dimensional array in this form. Okay, so here M is called a two-dimensional array. Okay, so what is the first dimension? 3. That means it contains 3 rows and each row contains 4 columns. 3x4 matrix now you can store in the two-dimensional array. Okay, now you know that when you declare, this is also a variable, array is also a variable here. Okay, so when you declare a variable, memory will be allocated. So how the memory is allocated for a two-dimensional array, that you need to understand here. Okay, so what I do is I'll draw the memory diagram for a two-dimensional array. So memory diagram of two-dimensional array, 2D array will take. Okay, right. So example, we'll take the same example. So same example, if I say int, I have M of 3 rows and 4 columns. So if I declare, then the memory diagram looks like this. 3 rows and each row contains 4 columns. Okay, so like this, some 3x4 memory will be allocated for this. This is the memory diagram of now this entire block of memory is identified by the name, with the name M. Okay, so this entire block, now this entire thing will be identified with the name M here. Okay, so how these rows and columns are identified then. Now see here, M contains, now this is first row, this is second row, and this is third row, 3 rows, and each row contains 4 elements, 1, 2, 3 and 4 elements. Okay, so same indexing will be followed here. Indexing will be same here. Now this first row will have index 0, then second row will have index 1, and third row will have index 2. Third row will have index 2. Similarly, this side will have, here it is, okay, so then this first column will be identified same with the index 0, second column will be identified with the index 1, third column will be identified with index 2, and the fourth column will be identified with index 3. Okay, so like this, both rows and columns both will have indexes starting from 0. Okay, so this is 0th column, this one. This is column number 1, this is column number 2, and this is column number 3. Similarly, this is row number 0, this is row number 1, this is row number 2. Okay, so what is the name of this entire block? That is M. Okay, now M is not a single location. Now M contains total 12 locations. 3 by 4 means 12 locations it contains. Now how we can access individual location here? Okay, now this entire thing is M here. So this first location that means is identified with row number 0 and column number 0. Okay, so that's why this location will be identified by the compiler using this notation here. Okay, so M of 0th row and 0th column, like this. M of 00, when you say it, indicates this. Okay, and how this location is identified? M of 01, row number 0 and column number 1 means this location. Okay, similarly, how this location is identified? Row number 0 and column number 2. Okay, so this is row 0 and column 2. And how this is identified? Row 0 and column 3. Okay, so similarly you can just write all the rows and columns here. I'll copy paste, then I'll change. Okay, so just you help me in identifying rows and columns here. Okay, so this is first row. Okay, right? Now how this is identified? This is row number 1, so that means first index will be 1, and this is column number 0. So M of 10 means this location. This is M of 11, this is M of 11. Okay, so this is M of 12, and this is M of 13. Okay, so how we can write this location? M of 20. Okay, so row number 2 and column number 0, and this is row number 2 and column number 1. How this element can be accessed here? Row number 2 and column number 2 here. And how this can be accessed? Row number 2 and column number 3. Okay, so like this, the two dimensional array elements or memory locations will be accessed using this index method. Okay, this is called array indexing method. Clear? Right. So now you have, once you know the memory locations notation, how it can be accessed, now you can assign the values to these individual memory location, like M of 00 is equal to assigning values. Just I'll give one or two examples how we can assign values to this. Okay, so assigning values to two dimensional array. Right, how we can assign the values? Now for example, M of 00, M of 00, okay, so is equal to 10. If I say M of 00 is equal to 10, if I say, then 10 will be stored in this array. Okay, so what I do is I copy this and just I'll paste this here. Okay, so now 10 will be stored in this first location. Now you know how to access individual location. So M of 00 is equal to 10 means 10 will be stored here. Okay, so similarly, now if you say M of 02 is equals to, okay, so something like 30, if you say, now where it will be stored? M of 02, this one. Okay, so here the number 30 will be stored. Okay, so now I'll be removing all these. Now this way you can store elements into two dimensional array. If I say M of, okay, so 2 Okay, so 2 and 3 is equals to, okay, so 55 if I say m of 2, 3, okay, second row and third column, okay, so this is second row, third column is 0, 1, 2, 3, index, please remember, index starts from 0 onwards, index starts from 0 onwards, okay, so this is 0th row, column, second row and third column, okay, so 0th column, first column, second column, this is, okay, so 55 will be stored here in this location, okay, so like this, the elements you can assign using assignment operator into the two-dimensional array. Okay, right, so once you know how to access the elements, how we can assign elements to two-dimensional array, then you can access using the same notation. Okay, so this way we can work with the two-dimensional arrays. Okay, right, so tomorrow I'll tell you a program where we can use a two-dimensional array. Okay, so first we'll write an example program, we'll store a matrix into a two-dimensional array, again from two-dimensional array we'll read elements and we'll print the matrix on the screen. Okay, so after that we can perform some addition of two matrices, multiplication of two matrices programs. Okay, so we'll stop today here, and all these videos are available on my YouTube channel. Okay, so if some of your friends misses today's class, you can just ask them to listen to my videos on YouTube channel. Okay, thank you all, and if you like these videos, please subscribe to my channel. Yeah, quickly, we'll take 1 minute time for your doubts. If you have any doubts, just drop some messages in the chat box.